30 for 30, presented by Levi's.
The story starts here. Troy, New York. Very early on, Oney discovered his natural athleticism and competitive drive. But while Oney's inherent talent showed much promise, he lacked discipline.
Our house was nothing but a mess at all times, and the biggest contributor to this mess was my sweet brother, Oney. We just called him Sloppy O. He was all over the place. We could never keep the house clean because of him.
Catholic school was the answer, something that left a lasting impression on Oney.
All righty, well then, tomorrow is the Super Bowl. A harmless recreational event or a vicious satanic death ritual? The judge. Now, I don't watch football, of course, because it's on the Sabbath. But apparently, in football, large, sweaty men collide at a high rate of speed to the apparent delight of onlookers. And the fans scream like little beastmasters, drink beer, and spit out. Well, isn't that special?
From there on, he was a different man. Clean cut, neat and tidy. You would have thought he went to military school. In the spring of 72, schools and scholarships came calling. The University of Vermont enticed Oney the most with their vast array of winter sports and notable alumni like great American jam band Phish. Here at UVM, Oney's sports career took off, quite literally, as he slid his way to the top of the record books and into the hearts of the Catamount community as an elite ice luger. His lightning speed and precision grew quite the fan base. The Ozone, as they became known, gathered for every one of Oney's runs.
He was just so fast. I was really impressed.
One fan in particular caught Oney's eye as he flew by at over 80 miles per hour.
I remember clearly when Oney met Marcia. They were both resident advisors at the University of Vermont, and it was because of their deep romance and hiding in these little broom closets and supply closets that their deep background intimate relationship resulted in a brand new policy for UVM that forbade any resident advisors from going into closets unobserved.
I just knew he was destined for greatness.
And when his country called, Oney answered, leading Team USA against the East Germans in the 12th Olympic Winter Games.
He's a big man and he's going quickly.
He certainly is, Jackie, and he got a terrific start right there. Coming out of that spin nice and clean, he's going right straight down to the three next large turns, which he is now really picking up speed.
Next stop, Texas A&M. Oney's skills on the water made quite a splash. A lone star in the floundering water sports program. They say everything is bigger in Texas, and the records he set were no exception. As his academic career ended, Oney moved from the water to the hardwood, landing a spot on the Boston Celtics practice squad. Oney's former teammate, Larry Bird.
Well, I thought he was very good. There's no question about it. I thought he was probably the best guard on the team. We didn't get to play a lot, but you could tell.
Still, Oney persisted, eventually earning a starting position next to Bird and generating national attention.
There's hope he can help solve professional basketball's difficulties.
But weeks into his rookie season, tragedy. While competing with his wife, Marcia, in an amateur figure skating competition, Oney slipped and fell. It was the fall that changed it all, hurting his wrist and his pride.
We were fine, but the Celtics had to cut him, and he took it really hard.
He didn't even talk about it for 10 years.
Years he spent trying to recover. He sought guidance from Deepak Chopra, hired a personal trainer.
I'm Hans.
And I'm Franz, and we just want to pop you on.
This is Houston, say again, please.
And eventually, leaving the world of sports and the earth.
Houston, we've had a problem.
We're just going to counter-wrap the copper wire.
Finally, he learned to rechannel his focus through tying flies. It wasn't the same as racing for his country or playing against NBA greats. Oney's recovery came from the satisfaction of knowing he could trick a little fish into thinking it was eating an insect. All this time outdoors led him to his second love of life, the potato. And when he wasn't in the river fishing, Oney was out on the farm. He had found peace with his past. Marsha, fly fishing, and potatoes were his life now. That is until he had two tater tots of his own.
Hi. How you doing, buddy?
Good.
Yeah, you're doing a great job with her, sweetheart.
Amy, excellent job.
Happy birthday, Dad.
With his days of competitive sports behind him and his newfound love of the tuber, Oney took his sizable wealth and donated it all to his charity, Buds of Spuds, where local musicians sing songs about the importance of fruits and vegetables.
She's chopping broccoli, chopping broccoli, chopping broccoli, chopping broccoli, chopping broccoli, chopping broccoli. She's chopping broccoli. She's chopping broccoli. She's chopping broccoli.
Before long, Oney found his footing again, standing in front of a classroom at Hood College and on the sidelines of every basketball game and soccer match. His love for sports rekindled by his new love for teaching, something his students always notice.
Well, personally, he was my favorite teacher at Hood.
He was probably the best advisor I had.
He's such a great advisor and works around the clock for every student to help make sure that they're doing the best that they can and the best that he can.
It was really neat to see like one of the faculty work with you to make sure you could get the most out of your college experience.
He's helped me as a professor, an advisor, as a friend, in all kinds of situations, and Hood is so grateful to have him.
And so the legend of Oney continues. From athlete to educator and proud potato enthusiast, he has grown quite the circle of fans, students, and mashed potato addicts. But it's much more than that. It's a circle of friends and family. It's a circle of admirers and those who follow his sagely advice to always make good decisions. For Oney himself, it comes down to a circle of trust, one that we're all so happy and lucky to be a part of.
Company. I'm sorry I can't be there. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Taylor. I'm Oney's nephew. I'm a comedian, and I was asked to do a roast for this event, and I agreed, but with a condition. Instead of a roast, I'm going to be doing a bake, because that is how you cook a potato. Yeah, lots of potato jokes. I got my ammo for this, did my research. I talked to Marsha, and she told me something interesting. She told me that fact, Oney is the only man that when cooking does not cry when cutting onions, but does cry when cutting potatoes, because he considers them part of the family. We actually have a special guest with us, a good friend of Oney's. I introduce to you former Cubs broadcaster, Harry Carey.
Hey! Happy birthday, Oney! Oh man, it's been a long time, my friend. You look good. Doesn't he look good, ladies and gentlemen? Let's give him a round of applause. 60 years old. He still looks like he would receive offers to be on the cover of Silver Fox magazine. I don't know if that's a real magazine, but if it is, he should be on it. Like Taylor, I did extensive research for this roast. I talked to Oney's childhood pediatrician. He told me that when Oney was little, that he thought he would never be a tall boy. I then talked to friends and family who told me that Oni's mother, to stop Oni's obsessive potato-only diet, will hide the spuds in high up, hard-to-reach places. And I think Oni just kind of willed himself to grow so that he could grab the potatoes. And he grew tall, didn't he? His mom had to be like, Oni, stop growing to grab all the potatoes, son. You gotta eat something else. And that's all I have for now. It's been a real pleasure, ladies and gentlemen. Happy birthday, Oni. I love you, and everybody at the party loves you.